but it was nearly the end of the year when she wrote, "I've found out why you sent me here, Stephen, and I'm glad you did." I had to be away from home on unavoidable business the day that Betty returned to Glenby. But the next afternoon I went over. I found Betty out and Sarah in. The latter was beaming. Betty was so much improved, she declared delightedly, I would hardly know the dear child. This alarmed me terribly. What on earth had they done to Betty? I found that she had gone up to the pine land for a walk, and thither I betook myself speedily. When I saw her coming down a long golden-brown alley, I stepped behind a tree to watch her. I wished to see her, myself unseen. As she drew near, I gazed at her with pride and admiration and amazement, and under it all a strange, dreadful heart-sinking, which I could not understand, and which I had never in all my life experienced before. No, not even when Sarah had refused me. Betty was a woman. Not by virtue of the simple white dress that clung to her tall, slender figure, revealing lines of exquisite grace and litheness, not by virtue of the glossy masses of dark brown hair heaped high on her head and held there in wonderful shining coils, not by virtue of added softness of curve and daintiness of outline, not because of all of these, but because of the dream and wonder and seeking in her eyes. She was a woman, looking all unconscious of her quest for love. The understanding of the change in her came home to me with a shock that must have left me, I think, something white about the lips. I was glad. She was what I had wished her to become. But I wanted the child Betty back. This womanly Betty seemed far away from me. I stepped out into the path, and she saw me with a brightening of her whole face. She did not rush forward and fling herself into my arms as she would have done a year ago, but she came towards me swiftly, holding out her hand. I had thought her slightly pale when I had first seen her, but now I concluded that I had been mistaken, for there was a wonderful sunrise of color in her face. I took her hand. There were no kisses this time. "Welcome home, Betty," I said. "Oh, Stephen, it is so good to be back," she breathed, her eyes shining.